So there you are.
Okay. All right. So our topic is, do ghosts really exist? And then, you know, I had a debate with Phil Smith at Portland State University, and he's a Christian philosopher at George Fox University. And from memory, I'm not sure. I think he said, well, of course, I don't believe in ghosts, like haunted houses and stuff like that. But I'm not sure about Pastor Nathan and some other people, so that's why it's kind of an interesting conversation. And then just in case they say, of course, I don't believe in these silly ghosts and haunted houses, and what's the biggest ghost of all? Is the Holy Ghost, you know, according to the King James Version, or called the Holy Spirit. So next slide. This is kind of a tongue-in-cheek thing. It says, you know, you plot the number of observances, the frequency of miracles. How often do they happen over time through history? You know, there's a constant rate of miracles, and all of a sudden, the camera's invented, and poof, there's no more miracle recordings, and then it's shot again. Wow, there's a lot of recordings again. What happened? Oh, well, Photoshop was invented. So, anyway, it's a lame attempt at a joke. Next slide. Kind of another joke, too, is how many charismatic evangelical Christians does it take to screw in a light bulb? Two, one to change the bulb and one to cast out the spirit of darkness. Okay, so one person found that one. So, you know, the idea, though, that's going to be throughout this whole thing that relates to that joke is that there's a way to see everything in the world as materially, and that's it. I mean, there's just matter, there's, you know, matter and energy, but there's just natural things. And then some people see a supernatural thing behind that. So, you know, if something bad happens, it must be the spirits or demons or God or something behind this. Or could it just, you know, maybe it's just bad. Maybe a bad thing just happened because that's nature. So anyway, those are two different mentalities we have. I do not have any superstitious or supernatural, and I would call it superstitious, but I don't have any supernatural beliefs whatsoever. So I think everything's about nature. So for me, a burnt-out bulb is just a burnt-out bulb, you know. And of course, no Christian believes it's a spirit of darkness, but that's just kind of an overstatement joke. Next slide. Okay, yeah, so let's go back to that one again, the previous one. So this is just something I saw on the internet. You know, like, what are people saying about ghosts? Well, here's one that said, oh, look at this guy. His friend took a picture of him, and there's this ghost in there, and the guy who took the picture freaked out and had a heart attack, you know. Well, is this true? These are the kind of stories you hear all the time. Next page. And, you know, maybe you say, obviously, that's not true. That's kind of corny. So I just wanted to, let's look at some counterpoints of, when you think of God as a Holy Spirit or a Holy Ghost, what's going on there? What are some examples? And so I showed some of the prime examples, probably from the Bible, I think what Pastor Nathan might agree with. And one is the baptism of Jesus, where it said the Holy Spirit came and descended upon Jesus in the form of a dove. So here we have the Holy Spirit, or ghost, or whatever, and it's manifesting as a dove. Then in Acts, it appeared as tongues of fire on top of people's heads. And then the story of Moses, it said during the day, Moses led the Hebrews by a pillar of fire and at night by a cloud. So these are different manifestations of the Holy Spirit, it's claimed. Next. So here's the general idea that Catholics and Protestants, I think, agree. They have this theological hypothesis that the body consists of a body. The body consists of the natural body and also a supernatural soul, and at death they separate. And like there in 2 Corinthians 5:8, Paul says to be absent from the body to be present with the Lord. So that means his soul or spirit is with God. But philosophical naturalism, which I'm representing, says there's no supernatural soul. The mind emerges from the brain. That's very important. And, you know, so obviously as the mind goes, the brain goes. So in other words, as the brain dies, the mind dies. As the brain develops, the mind gets more developed and complex. Next line. So here's some of my overview points. Number one, about the soul and the spirit. Number one is a lack of definition of what a soul or a spirit is in theological textbooks. Some of them say they're synonyms, they're the same thing, just different words, and some of them say they're two different things. So there's a lot of controversy over even what the Christians mean by the word. The second one is that we can observe from nature the emergence of the mind when we look across different animal species. They have different levels of brains, and they have different levels of thinking based on that. You know, we get all the different mammals, like whales and dolphins, and chimps and look at their behaviors. The next one is look at the observance of the emergence of the mind or in the human life cycle. You know, when you're first conceived and you're in the womb, there's just one cell there. There's no brain, there's no neurons, there's no activity whatsoever. There's obviously no mind. And as the neurons develop and all that, then your mind develops. And then if you get in the old age and get Alzheimer's or something, your mind starts to deteriorate because your brain's deteriorating. So that's all pretty obvious. There's an interesting, the next one is split brain data. There's an interesting case where sometimes your brain has a left hemisphere and a right hemisphere, and they communicate through this communication channel between the two, and sometimes they snip that in a medical operation for people who have seizures. And so what happens is now the left brain and right brain are kind of independent. And there's this funny story where this one doctor asked, you know, both left and right brain, like, you know, each one separately, do you know where you're at? I mean, are you in Oregon, for example, or are you asleep, and are you a male or female, and all this? And there were consistent answers, and then one question was, do you believe in God? Yes, no, or not sure. And the brain answered differently. One said, yes, I do, and the other one said, no, I don't. And so the doctor said, well, what's going to happen to this guy? Is he going to go to heaven or hell by not believing or not? So it basically shows that there is no such thing as a soul, really, that's overriding everything. I mean, what we are is really just a composite of our brain's neural activities. And so, anyways, it's kind of interesting that the left and right brain are both kind of independent in some ways. And it's basically like two consciousnesses. Some people say, can you divide conscious in half? Well, yeah, there's two different consciousnesses there, in a way. We can talk more about that in the question and answer time if you want. Biblical evidence against the resurrection. The next page. I'm saying here's some reasons for not believing the Bible stories about resurrection. And that's the only reason as a Christian you believe in resurrection is because of the Bible stories. In Matthew 27, you know, it talks about when Jesus died on the cross, his bodies came to life and they walked around, these were prophets of old. And he's like, well, what happened to these guys? They go back in their tombs at night, or they live long lives and die again, or what? It doesn't say. And it just, you know, from my experience in church, they never talk about this passage because it's kind of maybe something to be ashamed of or embarrassed about, because how do you explain what's going on there? It doesn't really make any sense. And it's kind of hard to say, well, maybe that was a later edition or something, because it seems to be in the earliest editions of Matthew where it's reported. It's only reported in Matthew also as a gospel. Another one is in Acts. Jesus, you know, ascends into heaven. He just physically goes up into heaven past the clouds. Well, that's where they thought heaven was, located up there. And now with the space program, we know heaven's not physically located up there. No Christian alive would probably say heaven is located up in the sky. But those guys thought heaven was literally up there, so when they made the story up, wow, you know. Of course, he went according to their cosmology. So I think they got caught red-handed telling a story on that one. And then, you know, furthermore, they say Jesus is going to return from heaven the same way. So that's why you're going to see him come in the clouds, because that's where heaven is up there. Another passage is Mark 16. It says, you know, for the believers, if they drink poison, it won't kill them at all. Well, obviously, poison does kill the believers. Was there an expiration on that promise? Like only for the first 50 years or something? And in that one, it is easy to say, well, that was a later edition because the earlier manuscripts don't have it. But now your question is, well, why is this in the Bible if it's not part of the original? Well, because if you took it out, it'd probably be a big commotion there. Why are these passages missing from the Bible? So, you know, that's just one of the problems there. So why was the soul invented?
That's your man.
So I got 1 minute?
Yep.
Okay, so why was the soul invented? My theory, which is very popular theory probably among atheists, is that, you know, a lot of people are afraid of death and they don't want to face their death. It's hard to come, you know, face it, so it's just a way of denial. There's actual thing called terror management theory about why people invent things to avoid death or thinking about it. So my advice is just the ultimate solution is to accept it, accept your place in nature, and learn how to deal with it, and that's a long topic in itself, but that's my summary for this thing.
Okay. All right, you ready, Nathan?